welcome Dr. Stahel.
Okay. As George has set up today, I'm going to talk about the battle for Moscow. Now, this is a very, very large battle, both in terms of scale and in terms of the time period in which it takes place. We're basically looking at a period from the beginning of October right through to April 1942. So October 1941 to April 1942. So there's a lot to get through, and I'm going to do my best to address the most important part for my research, which is the German offensive phase from the beginning of October through to the 5th of December 1941. Those are the areas that I've written on. Those are the areas that I've spent the most amount of time in the archive looking at. And I think there's a tremendous amount in that. And, you know, in such an enormous war, I think there's sometimes a tendency for people to take in an enormous amount in one go. And I'd rather target our information and our time very specifically so that I can address two things. And this is what I want to try and do tonight. On the one hand, I'm aware that our audience has a number of people who read a great deal. And I think that poses an issue when you're trying to write a lecture, because normally you want to have a sense of where your audience is at. And typically your audience is, at least in the university, all on the same level. They're all in the same course. They've all had the same background. But I think both the people who are coming tonight and the fact that this ends up on the internet, there's an enormous number of people out there who have a great deal of background knowledge. So I want to address both sides. I want to, on the one hand, explain what happened, so that if you've got no context, no knowledge of the Battle for Moscow, this lecture will essentially make sense to you. But I also want to address another question, and I think it's the real thesis behind my... I've actually got two books looking at this battle for Moscow. The first one looks at October. The second one looks at November through to the 5th of December. And I think there the thesis is what makes those books most interesting, because the thesis is essentially asking another question, not just outlining what happened, but answering that really critical question, why does it happen the way it does? And I think as we progress through the lecture, and I hope for a lot of you, you'll be asking yourself the same question. Why is this happening? If Dr. Stahel is correct in everything he's saying, why is this battle developing the way it is? Why is it understood by the Germans the way it's being understood? And I will flag that for you at various points. And then about halfway through, what I want to do is then directly address that question. So there's a lot to get through. And I'd like to start by first saying that there's a traditional view. And if you have read something on the Battle for Moscow, you'll perhaps be aware of it. It's often set up as this kind of knife-edge battle. On the one hand, the Germans begin their offensive at the beginning of October. They have an enormous degree of success early on, and then they drive all the way to the gates of Moscow. But the understanding of German success is often correlated between where the German armies are and their distance to the Kremlin, or the distance to the central parts of Moscow. And so as that distance gets shorter, it's often set up in some of these history books as the Germans are closer and closer to this astonishing victory. And the premise is often, if they could achieve their goal, if they could capture Moscow, the Soviet Union would somehow collapse, and that would be the end of resistance. And I think this is a real problem. And I think that it comes largely from the fact that when authors are setting up their books, a lot of authors aren't necessarily working for the best scholarly work. They're working for the best seller, essentially. And that's a very dramatic story to sort of set up, this idea that the Germans are on the precipice of victory, and at the last moment, the Soviets, from seeming defeat, snatch a victory and launch their counteroffensive, saving the Soviet Union. In reality, things aren't quite so simple. And I will put to you, and I think quite conclusively, that irrespective of how close those German armies are to Moscow, and they do get very close, the prospects for German victory in terms of taking Moscow, and certainly in terms of conquering the Soviet Union, are next to nothing. Okay, so a little bit of background. As I say, the operation begins on the 2nd of October, 1941, but there's a number of things. This war has been going on for over 3 months at this point. Now, if you've heard the last lecture last year, and if you haven't, that's fine, but basically looking at the summer campaign when there was an enormous amount of success, we have to see that success in context. the Soviet Union is losing a tremendous amount of territory. They, if you look at the number of tanks, the number of men they lose, the number of aircraft, they are staggering numbers. So it's natural to conclude, on the one hand, that the Soviet Union has suffered one of the greatest defeats in military history, and that is true. I think what we have to understand, and the basic point of that lecture last year, was the benchmark is different on the Eastern Front of the Second World War. This is warfare on a scale we have never seen before in any other war. I mean, the Soviets are going to lose 3 million men in the course of 1941. Now, no other army in history has lost such a number and then reconstituted their army as that's happening and continue to fight a high-intensity, resource-intensive war for many, many more years to come. I mean, the total Soviet losses in the Second World War are 27, 28 million people. So you can get a sense, even if you've never really had much to do with this war in the East, of just how important it is, not just for the Second World War, but in terms of military history. And again, this scale is different. One has to have an appreciation for that, so that when we look at these numbers and what seems to be so staggering, these losses for the Soviet Union, they are only important insofar as how much of a dent does that make in Soviet mobilization. So if I tell you that the Soviet mobilization base at the start of the Second World War is 14 million men, and that they are raising millions in the course of that year, that then has an impact when we hear the figure 3 million lost. How big is the Soviet army by the end of the German offensive? I think I've got the figure somewhere in here. It's about 4.1 million men across a very long Eastern Front. But clearly, there is an army still very much in being, and the Germans haven't been successful in their core objective, and that is crushing the Red Army, stopping or being able to eliminate Soviet resistance. That's the one thing they have to do in 1941. That's the one thing they haven't been able to do. And therefore, what appears on the surface from those statistics, if we just looked at statistics as a resounding success, has to be seen in context to be, in fact, not enough to achieve their objective, which places Germany in a very difficult position because they did not intend, they did not plan for, and they have no contingency for a long, high-intensity war in the East when they've also got, of course, a war against Great Britain, a war against the British Empire, pouring resources in, building up armies, and is going to be able to then take advantage of the fact that the German army is overwhelmingly concentrated in the East and being consumed in the East, as the British also build up strength. And of course, the United States is involved, not directly, of course, until Pearl Harbor, but Lend-Lease is still taking place. It's been enacted since 1940, and that is extended from the summer of 1941 to the Soviet Union, which is to say that American industry is supplying the Eastern Front. It's going to take months and months, of course, until they've got the shipping and they've been able to turn industry from civilian production to military production, but it's coming. And it's there. And a lot of the Lend-Lease supplies that have been sent to Great Britain are going to find themselves turning up on the Eastern Front in the Battle of Moscow. And as I say, we shall come to that. So we have to understand that the German army going into Typhoon is an army that has been in this resource-intensive war for 3 months now. And on the offensive, they lose enormous amounts. So we can look at those Soviet statistics and say, wow, it's a disaster for the Soviets, and it truly is a disaster. But for example, just off the top of my head, one of the stats is that in July 1941, the German army loses, just dead, not casualties, just dead, 63,000 men. Now that's almost, off the top of my head, it's about, I think, 68,000 men that are killed in the United States, in Vietnam, in all the years of that fighting. That's 1 month on the Eastern Front, and that's a successful month for the Germans. July 1941, they are taking large tracts of lands, they are fighting successful battles, but we mustn't forget this is a costly exercise. And what's particularly important here is also it's costly for those Panzer forces that are driving the German army forward. That's where the losses are heaviest, because they are at the forefront of the battle. And these are the forces, 3 months in, having suffered all these losses, that are going to drive on Moscow and that have already sustained so much damage. We're looking at a tank force for Operation Typhoon of about 1,500 tanks. So that's a considerable amount of a number of tanks. But we also have to understand that that's not just what Army Group Center has. Army Group Center is the central German army group on the Eastern Front and by far the biggest, especially by October 1941. There are three army groups, Army Group North, Army Group Center, Army Group South. But they have essentially stripped Army Group South and Army Group North to provide extra offensive firepower, tanks particularly, to drive Typhoon forward. Typhoon is the code name for the offensive toward Moscow. Army Panzer Group 4 has been diverted down to Army Group Center. So Army Group Center started the war with two Panzer groups. Now they've got a third. And there's a fourth Panzer group, Panzer Group 1, which is an Army Group South. They've kept their Panzer group, but they've had to give up one corps. The bottom line is a large number of offensive firepower, really the best of the Eastern Front, is being now concentrated in Army Group Center to give this the best chance of success, but also in recognition of the fact that the Panzer forces in Army Group Center have been worn down, and if this is going to have any chance of success, they're going to have to concentrate all their firepower in the center. George also alluded to another important point, logistics. That was one of the things that plagued the German offensive in the summer, and it's going to have another very real implication for the offensive toward Moscow. It's a little bit hard to get statistics on all the German armies that make up Army Group Center, but for example, the 4th Army, which is the biggest army there, it's also got Panzer Group 4 subordinated to it, and that's the biggest of the four Panzer groups on the Eastern Front. There's a very clear evidence that they're living hand to mouth in September. So the month before the offensive, the 4th Army, the biggest army, is living hand to mouth. Now this is a really important thing. If you're going to drive your army group forward, the one thing you need to do is build up supplies, because as you project yourself, you have to have these fuel dumps and these supplies to do that. And from where the German line is to their objective, Moscow, it's 300 or so kilometers. So you're going to have to go a very long distance, and the Soviet armies are very much in the way. So it's not as though, and I read this once on the internet, someone was discussing my work and saying, oh, I don't agree with Stahel. Stahel says that it's 300 kilometers to Moscow, and the German trucks, surely they had enough fuel to drive 300 kilometers. That's one of the mistakes. Do they have enough fuel to drive 300 kilometers? Often, actually, they don't. But even if you do have enough, even if one of the units said, well, actually, we've got enough to drive on a road directly straight ahead 300 kilometers, of course, launching an offensive of that distance does not mean that you get into your tank or you get into your truck and you just drive on the objective. What's happening is encirclements, where you're not driving in a straight line. Trucks are typically driving from their fuel dumps or their ammunition dumps to the front line, and then back again to pick up more, and then back again to pick up more. They need troops here, then they need troops here. Everything's driving in every other direction. You need vastly more fuel than just the linear distance from point A to point B in order to achieve your objective. As I'm sure many people know, but they're perhaps not always thinking about, you need vast stocks of supplies to do something like an offensive on the Eastern Front of 300 kilometers. And the Germans certainly don't have this. But the German army exists in a world where they're always emphasizing the positive. They always see the best case scenario. And even if they can't answer every question with a very positive, very optimistic framework, they hope that things along the way will just fall into place. Perhaps the Soviet army will finally collapse. Perhaps we'll capture fuel dumps. Surely we must capture fuel dumps. And that will then allow us to do what on paper we can see now we can't do. The Quartermaster General, a man named Wagner, states early on in October, operational goals are being set that earlier would have made our hair stand on end, eastward of Moscow. I think that says something else. He's the man responsible as the Quartermaster General for supplying this offensive. And he's already aware that these objectives are being set that are not just making his hair stand on end, but are eastward of Moscow. One of the key things in what I'm going to be presenting on tonight is, in a sense, the irrationality of what the Germans are attempting to do. And I think time and again you'll get to see just how far from reality a lot of these people are operating. And it's not, and this is a very important point, it is not all about Hitler. If you read their memoirs after the war, they love to say, oh, well, yes, we were forced to do X, Y, Z, and it was all Hitler. Believe me, I've spent enough months in the German military archive going through this, where these men aren't on an everyday level having access to Hitler. They are writing their own plans, and they aren't complaining about what they're doing. Indeed, they're suggesting it. The German high command is deeply implicated in the military mistakes of not just the Battle of Moscow, the Second World War. Make no mistake of this. So as I say, Moscow is 300 kilometers away. Army Group Center, though, is a very large army group. It takes up about 700 kilometers of the Eastern Front. And it's not as though it is just Moscow. I mean, I'm as guilty as anyone. I called my recent book The Battle for Moscow, and I'm talking about Army Group Center's offensive. But in a sense, it's not just the case that they are driving on Moscow. They are driving along this front. For example, in the north, Yaroslav, it's not on my maps because it's so far to the east, it's 500 kilometers from their starting line. And towards the end of October, as they've had an initially successful early phase, Reinhardt, the commander of the 3rd Panzer Group, is talking about capturing Yaroslav, 500 kilometers away. And if you think the logistics situation is bad at the beginning, by then it's catastrophic. And that doesn't stop him suggesting these kinds of ideas. And on the other end of the front, down on the south, they're going to be looking at Voronezh, which is 385 kilometers from the starting line of Typhoon. But again, we will come to a lot of this. I hope from this opening introduction, you can get a little bit of a sense, though, of why what I said at the beginning is so important, that we have to address this question of why. Why are they doing this? This doesn't seem to make much sense. Okay, so now I'm going to try this technology side of things, and I believe I can show you my map if I go onto this. Hang on, it's not coming up. There it is. Can you see my map? No? Share screen. Okay, can you see my map now? That's good. I can hear someone murmuring yes. Okay, good. Okay, so here is the map, right? This is the 3rd of October. Maybe I can scroll down there a little bit. Yeah, the 3rd of October, 1941. The blue is, of course, the Germans. What I tried to make red, but I think is orange, are the Soviet forces. Now, it's very confusing, I know, to just look at a map like this. But this is the central part of the Eastern Front. Well, the northern and the central part of Army Group Center. The southern part isn't on there. But this is the main point of the offensive. Now, here, this is Panzer Group 3. This is one of their three Panzer Groups. And the other one is here, the 4th Panzer Group. And these are driving into the Soviet front. So you can see here, there's a northern offensive, there's a southern offensive, and these forces here are largely static. They are not trying to push in. Because what the German army does, and what it does so well throughout this period of the opening offensive phase, is what we sort of colloquially refer to as blitzkrieg, which is this highly offensive form of warfare. But it isn't as though they try and push the entire front forward. They are pushing forward in specific areas in order to enact encirclements. And that's what they're doing here. So we can see here, Panzer Group 3, Panzer Group 4, driving into, you can see these small arrows, driving into the Soviet front. And the idea is to encircle large, high-quality Soviet formations. We've got here the 19th Army, the 16th Army, the 20th Army, the 24th Army, and pushing forward as a reserve is this 32nd Army. Now, if they are to meet the 3rd and the 4th Panzer Group at Vyazma here, they're hoping to encircle a very large part of the Soviet Western Front, which is the main force defending Moscow. And they figure if we achieve this, if we can destroy all of these armies, multiple armies, then surely the Soviets can't reconstitute them before we can drive on Moscow. The problem with assuming this in October 1941 is that they have tried this before at the Battle of Minsk, the Battle of Smolensk, the Battle of Kiev, and each time, in fact, the Soviets have been able to reconstitute their front. Have a look here. There's a reserve front, and there are more reserve armies behind this that are being formed up in various military districts behind the front line and around the Soviet Union. They will be rushed in when this first big battle takes place. There's also another offensive taking place further south with smaller forces, and that's going to center on Brandt down here, and I'll talk more about that. What's not on this map is much further south is the 2nd Panzer Group, that's Guderian's Panzer Group, and that's driving up to Tula, to Oral in October 1941. I think if I click this stop sharing, you'll get me again. Oh, are you getting me?
Yes,
or have you got the map?
No, we got you.
You got me?
Yeah.
Okay, good. Okay, great. As you saw that map on the 4th of October, remember that was only, that map was from the, I think the 2nd or the 3rd of October. On the 4th of October, 1941, Franz Helder, who is the chief of the Army General Staff, so the most important person coordinating the offensive on the Eastern Front, from the German High Command. The commander of Army Group Center is a man named Bock. He is at the front, or in the High Command, in the headquarters. But Helder is the chief of the German, the Army General Staff. And he writes on the 4th of October, "Operation Typhoon is developing on a truly classic course. The enemy is holding all parts of the front not under attack, which bodes well for the establishment of pockets." So you can see there that this is working very well to Germany's favor in the opening act of Operation Typhoon. It's also the case that the weather in this opening week is excellent. It actually hasn't been excellent through a large part of September. There's been rain, it's been overcast, but in that opening week of October, it's like summer weather. In fact, the 5th Panzer Division's war diary refers to glorious weather and then offensive weather, as they say. So the roads are dry, they're not sealed roads, so it really matters what the weather is like. The roads are dry, the skies are sunny, and they're able to advance. This is what's going to facilitate the encirclement of the Soviet Western Front, largely in the period between the front line and Vyazma. But there are a number of things early on that are really setting up the long-term problem of Typhoon. And on the 5th of October, so what is that, 4 days into the offensive, the 4th Panzer Division, which is the lead Panzer Division of Guderian's Panzer Group, 2nd Panzer Group, which is that one in the very south, we couldn't see it on the map, it's actually had to stop the offensive 4 days in because it simply has no more fuel. And they're going to have to wait there quite some period, I think about 24 hours before they can get fuel up again. One of the ideas of Blitzkrieg is to keep attacking, and as your enemy is, in a sense, knocked off balance, you never let them regain balance because you keep pushing and pushing and pushing. That explains German successes in the early period of its offensive, and it's the same model being enacted in Typhoon, with the caveat that the German forces have difficulty maintaining, even in the opening days of the offensive, their momentum, simply because the logistics just aren't there to sustain it. The other problem they have is not just the raw amount of logistics that they have, the supplies at the front line or in these ammunition dumps and so on, but is getting it to the front, because one of the attritional factors, I mean, the Germans have poured an enormous amount in building up their tank armies, but one of the things I argue in the book is they are tank heavy. Have they got enough offensive firepower to drive their armies forward? Absolutely they do. They have stripped everything else to provide that punch, so to speak, to drive through the Soviet front lines and to keep on driving. The problem is tank armies don't operate in a vacuum. They must have logistics behind them. They must have this trail of trucks that are going to continue to bring up. And the more tanks you have, the more supplies you need, more ammunition, more fuel. They are very fuel intensive. You need to have this convoy of trucks bringing forward the supplies. And the further you go, the more trucks you need for the immediacy of supply. The distances get greater, the aggregate time taken for a truck to drive to the front line, drive all the way back, pick up more supplies, and then get back to the tanks who need it, takes longer. So the further the offensive goes, the longer between supply runs. And that's not helped if then when the trucks get there, they themselves are having to wait 12 hours for the next train to arrive or the next trucks bringing up more supplies to the forward dumps. So that's a problem for Guderian. It's also a problem for the 46th Panzer Corps, which is the lead Panzer Corps of Panzer Group 3. So we've got two of the three Panzer Groups who were taking part in Operation Typhoon stalled 4 days in simply because they haven't got enough supplies. This is a really ominous omen for what's going to happen in this battle, especially when one recalls this is the best period they're ever going to have because the weather is favorable. This is the one time they can't really afford it because this is when they can make their offensive count most. Okay, I want to take you to another map now, because I've got four in total. Hang on a second, this just takes a moment to load up. Okay, the next map is from the 7th of October. I hope you can see that now, it's on my screen. And you can see what's happened. They've encircled the two army group, the two panzer groups have met at Vyazma, that's here. And we now have a huge encirclement. It's not the largest the Germans have ever achieved. The largest was just slightly larger at Kiev, which was in September 1941. And here we've got, you can see the 19th Army, the 20th Army, the 32nd Army, and elements of other armies, and a very, very large, we're talking about 600 or just shy of 600,000 troops generally that are encircled at what is called the Vyazma encirclement. So that's a staggering number. I think it's also important to though recognize how do these encirclement battles work? The Soviets have been encircled, okay? Through bad practice, as Helder recognized, they were trying to hold on that line, and they have then been encircled. In theory, what you're supposed to do with this mobile operation is a better practice, and it's a practice that both armies will slowly learn as this goes on, is that you keep the large bulk of your armies back from the front, you screen the front with light forces, so that once you can identify where the enemy are making their penetration, you haven't then got all of your forces committed to the front line, you've got them back so you can then counterattack the Panzerspitze, the attack point, the point of main concentration. You can attack that with the bulk of your forces and not be subject to these encirclements. But that's clearly what's happened here at Vyazma. What's important is though, to enact an encirclement, you need these mobile forces, and you can see them. 6th Panzer Division is here on the eastern flank, the 7th Panzer Division, the 10th, the 2nd here, the 5th Panzer Division. This is why they're going to be suffering and have been suffering such losses throughout Barbarossa and indeed through Operation Typhoon, because those most important forces are taking, in a sense, the most dangerous part of the operation. It's not so dangerous to break through, it's not so dangerous to enact an encirclement, but what happens next? All of these Soviet forces, it's not like on the Western Front when British or French forces got encircled, they typically surrendered. It's over. Militarily, they're at a lost cause. Not on the Eastern Front. This is a war of ideologies and people don't tend to surrender. They will all try and break out. There will be fanatical attempts at breaking out, particularly through the 7th, 10th, 2nd, and 5th Panzer Divisions. Most of which will end in utter catastrophe, with huge numbers of Soviets just being literally mowed down as they approach those forces. But in some cases, they will penetrate through the front lines and they will drive right through these Panzer divisions and into the German rear areas. So I think it's very important to recognize that, because the losses for Panzer forces is the most important thing for an offensive. This period here, to get to Vyazma, is about 100 kilometers into their offensive. So you've got another 100 kilometers to Moskhaysk here, and about another 100 kilometers to Moscow. These forces are going to have to then turn around at the end of this battle and drive another 200 kilometers. And they have been worn down quite severely by this very attritional fighting that's going to take place here. In other words, again, we can come back to that same point I made earlier. Will it be a catastrophe for the Soviets? Yes. Will they lose large numbers of forces dead and something like 500,000 prisoners? Absolutely. But and in total, in these early phase, they will lose about 1 million men. About 1 million men will be wiped off the Soviet order of battle, not just at Vyazma, but also at Bryansk and further south where the 2nd Army is fighting, not just the 2nd Panzer Army or the 2nd Panzer Group. They will lose about 1 million men. It's 1.2 million men who were in the Soviet Western Front and Reserve Front who are defending Moscow at the beginning of Typhoon. And at the end of this, we'll be talking about 1 million who are no longer there. And when I say the end of this, I mean about the middle of October 1941. And while that figure is staggering, let's not kid ourselves into believing that these German panzer forces, who are so important for continuing the offensive, haven't themselves also suffered some very severe losses. I hope you're getting me back again. One of the other things I would say about this is when you looked at that when you looked at that encirclement, that's around about 80 square kilometers. I didn't actually think to convert all of my mileages to miles for you, but they are all in kilometers. That's a very, very large area. 80 square kilometers is a vast battlefield. And about 2 years ago, I had the opportunity to go to Russia for a documentary. And one of the things that they wanted to do was to film on the battlefields of Vyazma. And the idea was to go out there with a group of Russian volunteers who are called Svezda in Russian. And they are basically searchers. And their idea is they go out there every summer as volunteers and they try to locate Soviet war dead. There are large numbers who, of course, when you're talking in that sort of scale, who have been lost in the battle and the family never knew what happened to them. And there's no way sometimes of finding out. But at least when they dig up these bodies, they can rebury them with full military honors. So Svezda are going out there and doing this. And what the producer of this documentary wanted to do was go out there and get a bit of a sense. What can we film? What's there? Is there anything to film? And is it possible we can go out there and see them digging up this battlefield? Because, of course, they put metal detectors on and they dig up bayonets and, you know, gas masks and all these things. And one of the things I remember from that day was the producer was somewhat worried. It's quite a way out to where they wanted to go digging. And he said, well, I just don't want to get out there with this crew and with all the people. It's a drive with four-wheel drives through these forests, and then we get out of the four-wheel drives and we have to walk through all these trees. And I just don't want to get out there, and then we've got nothing to film because we'll lose the day. So could you please bring a few trinkets, helmet, things, so just in case we have a bad day, we've still got something to put on the documentary. And I remember the Russian man he was talking to was sort of saying, yeah, you don't have to worry about this. And the producer, you know, no, it would just be better, please, you know, could we just for safety's sake, just, you know, put a few things in a backpack and we'll take them out there. And the Russian guy was sort of saying, you don't need to worry about it. Anyway, of course, he did take a few things out there. But one can understand the Russian's point of view when we got out there and the people put their metal detectors on and no kidding, it's just a forest as you would see anywhere else. It didn't look like there was no sign that there'd ever been a battle here. Of course, these trees have grown up since the battle. They put these metal detectors on, they took a few paces, and all over, metal detectors are going off. They start digging in the ground, and within minutes, gas masks, helmets, bayonets, rifles, shell fragments, all of this stuff is literally coming up out of the ground. Pretty much, you didn't need a metal detector wherever you dug. You would find things. And it was quite staggering. And I just had to think to myself, okay, here we were expecting, as perhaps we might on other battlefields, if we found anything at all, we'd consider ourselves lucky. And it was apparent to me that right where we were standing, an entire Soviet division or something had been completely decimated because everything was under the ground. You'd only have to dig down 30 centimeters or so, and there it all was. And later on, as we progressed through the forest, there was clearly a car. That was one thing that was above ground that you could see had been quite literally torn to pieces by a shell. And the other thing about that is how dangerous it all is. And I hadn't really thought about that, but at one point I was digging with one of the searchers. He had his metal detector go off and he pulls up this piece of metal and I'm sitting right next to him and he bangs it on a tree, this piece of metal, trying to get the dirt on it to come off. And he suddenly froze. And I said, oh, what's wrong? And he said, bomber. And he was holding a hand grenade that he'd just dug up, but he didn't know it was a hand grenade, of course, when he's banging it on the tree. But not surprisingly, I heard, and I don't know if the statistic is correct, but one of the searchers, one of the Russian searchers told me that one searcher is killed every year on these expeditions around Russia, trying to find Russian war dead, which is also a frightening statistic to think that 70 years after the war, people are quite literally still being killed by the ordnance from that time. But I think the other thing is, if one looks at Vyazma, we were based in Vyazma for that day, and we were driving, I think we were in the car for a good 2 hours, okay, we're going over roads that aren't really meant for anything other than four-wheel drives, but driving for that length of time, and all the area around which we were driving was a battlefield. it's a staggering scale. I mean, I've been working on this war for a good 20 years, from right when I was a student, when I would just read the stuff as a as an interested student, through postgraduate work, and now as a professional historian. And I still find myself sometimes floored by those statistics. And I think in some ways the historians are the worst for seeing numbers and not always relating it back. And I think it's something we need to really recall, that every one of those numbers is really a person. As Tim Schneider said in his wonderful book, we have to turn those numbers back into people. And I think he's absolutely correct. Okay, so Vyazma is an enormous battle, and there are very serious losses for those Panzer forces in that victory. It's clearly a victory, and I'm not trying to ameliorate the German success there. What we do, though, have to keep in mind is that success has a very real cost for the German army. On the 9th of October, so just as that Vyazma battle is still taking place, Soviet forces, as of the 9th of October, they've been encircled from the 7th. That's the map we saw. By the 9th, they are all in full flight, trying to flee through those German panzer divisions. And there is extremely heavy fighting, not so much in the day, but in the night. That's when the Soviets can figure out this is our best chance of penetrating these German defenses. Very few will actually get through. Some will, but very, very few. By the 9th of October, back in Berlin, Otto Dietrich, who is the Reich press chef, the press correspondent for the Nazi Party, basically, he calls together the international press, and he states that the campaign in the East has been decided by the smashing of Army Group Timoshenko. That's a direct quote. Timoshenko is actually incorrect. That used to be the commander of the Western Front. It wasn't since September. He's down in the south as the commander of Southwestern Front. It was Konev at this time, and it's now going to be Gogorky Zhukov as the new commander of the Western Front. But he's essentially correct. Western Front has been crushed, but it's interesting to see that the Germans are now proclaiming outright victory. The campaign in the East has been decided. Essentially what they're saying is there's no more major combat. It's just a matter of now occupying distant places, not unlike Moscow. The campaign in the East has been decided, was the headline on the 10th of October in the Nazi newspapers. The great hour has struck, the military end of the Bolsheviks. You can see the hubris here of the German Nazi Party. Now, I don't want to ascribe all of that to the German field commanders. It depends on the personality. Some of them really were jubilant. I mean, there was a degree of jubilation. You can well imagine they have now encircled a vast part of the Soviet front. But I think there is also those at the highest level who were skeptical as to the fact that they were now hearing in their own propaganda that the campaign in the East has been decided. Some of them were pulling back at that point. But what's really interesting is the reaction of many soldiers. Part of my histories is not just to look at that archival, what we would say in history, top-down perspective, which is, of course, very important for reconstructing these campaigns. And I'm not just looking at the high command. I like to look at the army group, the armies, the panzer groups, the corps, and the divisions, which generates an enormous amount of paperwork. So it's no small task to do this. But I think while one gets that important perspective, and I think I could just say one more thing on that, the perspective you get from that highest level of the German files is very much infected with the Nazi Party ideology, even in the military circles, as I was saying earlier. As you go further down, once you get down to the corps and the divisions most particularly, these forces aren't as infected with this. You get a lot more reality. I think one of the things about my earlier books that made such an impact was earlier historians have taken that highest level of files and used those to inform their histories. And then when I found I was going much further, I was getting a very different picture of the war. A lot of these military problems to do with logistics, to do with how the tanks operate and all the things they haven't got, how the Luftwaffe operates and combines with the army and all the problems they've got, the exhaustion of the forces, that is much clearer in the corps and division files than it is at the other level. And I think one needs to bear that in mind. But beyond all of this, I also like to look at the bottom-up perspective, which is to say the everyday German soldier's perspective, from letters, from diaries that they kept at the time. And one of the things from one of the German soldiers' journals that he wrote on the 10th of October, which I think is very instructive as to how the German soldiers were typically interpreting their own propaganda, which they could hear on the radios. On the radio, we heard the news of the victorious encirclement near Vyazma and Bryansk. The Eastern campaign has practically been decided. The remnants of the Red Army are one step away from annihilation. I grabbed my head. How is this possible? Has our leadership gone mad overnight? All of this is not true. It cannot be true. All of us hear too clearly what is going on. Did these gentlemen have blindfolds on their eyes? Again, I want to flag that point for you that I started with. There is a very real question here for why. Why is this happening? Why is, on the one hand, on a most basic level, why are they projecting success when the one thing you would have to say the Germans should have learned, because they went down this path already in late June 1941, only 10 days after their offensive, when they'd enacted the encirclement at Minsk, and they're proclaiming, well, that's pretty much it. I mean, there's a quote in Helder's diary on the 3rd of July 1941 where he talks about the Eastern campaign has practically been decided. At that point, you could perhaps at least forgive them for thinking, well, if we annihilate this enormous part of Soviet, enormous number of Soviet divisions and ultimately armies, you know, we're going to, by a classical military understanding of warfare, march on because we've eliminated their army and they can't reconstitute it. But after you've had that experience at Minsk, and they have in fact reconstituted their army within weeks, so that you're having to do it all again at Smolensk, and then having had to do it again at Kiev, and now Army Group Center is once again driving forward and seemingly having success, and there's no denying that it's a battlefield victory. Operationally, they have been successfully, but ascribing that operational success to a strategic success, i.e. the campaign has been decided, that's an extraordinary lack of a learning curve. And yet the German command do this routinely, even at the military level. They are not planning for a success. They believe now that largely they have succeeded against the Soviet forces, and the rest will be a matter of advancing. And this is very problematic for German soldiers who themselves have experienced the same war, but aren't perhaps, as the man says, with a blindfold on their eyes about the ease with which this advance will continue. Okay, so going into the rest of October, there are a number of other developments. As I said before, it's not as though everything is happening in the direction of Moscow. That's clearly the main thrust. That's what's going to happen now that they've seized Vyazma, 100 kilometers. They're going to drive on Moskhayask, which is the next major town on the road to Moscow. But very importantly, Army Group Center, and this is part of the hubris that they're experiencing, they begin to dissipate their armies. They are driving north to a place called Kalinin, where they're going to send an entire Panzer Corps. In fact, they're going to send the entire 3rd Panzer Group north to Kalinin in order to seize that objective. In the hubris of the times, they're not even thinking about just taking Kalinin, which they will do, but they then want to attack further north and encircle the Soviet front that's opposing Army Group North. This is perhaps not the easiest thing to do without a better map, but Army Group North is holding its line and it's not really on the offensive. There's a small part that's on the offensive in October 1941 from Army Group North. But essentially the idea is if we drive up behind the northwestern front with elements of Army Group Center, the 3rd Panzer Group, we can encircle, again, large numbers of Soviet forces. And the offensive is continuing all the way down. We've got the 9th Army in the north, which is the first part of Army Group Center. We've got the 4th Army. We've got the 2nd Panzer Group, which is operating independently. There's no army that is controlling it. And then further south, we've got the 2nd Army, not to be confused with the 2nd Panzer Group, which in early October will become the 2nd Panzer Army. So we've got the 2nd Panzer Army and the 2nd Army. It's two different armies. And they are all on the offensive. They are all driving forward. But importantly, if you could look at a map, they are driving out from each other, not all driving on one position. This means that there is not just a problem for the Germans in terms of the depth of their offensive, but they are dissipating their forces, and they're doing it quite deliberately. And again, Hitler is not stepping in and saying, you must do this. It's very much being directed by the generals. It's successful at this point. Hitler doesn't see the need to be involving himself so directly and directing the campaign. In fact, there's a relative, not even a relative, there is a very striking degree of harmony throughout this entire opening phase of the battle for Moscow. Operation Typhoon does not see screaming matches, Hitler arguing with his generals. It's all very harmonious. It wasn't always that way in the summer of 1941. There is one big strategic sort of blow up about differences of opinion. Should they go to Kiev? Should they go direct to Moscow? They go down to Kiev. It's astonishingly successful in terms of the fact that they destroy a Soviet front. But that's not the story of Typhoon. So all of these decisions that are taking place are taking place in harmony. The German army, in other words, is not protesting them. And the problem that the German generals will later write about in terms of why Typhoon fails, they will blame it on two things, because they can't point to any dispute with Hitler. They will have to blame it on the weather. After that initial 1 week of nice weather, the weather will turn. It will start to rain. One of the things they say about the reason Typhoon fails is the weather. Oh, but the weather came, it turned much, sorry, the winter came much earlier. Well, it is colder than an average year. Is it so much colder that everyone's shocked by how cold it is? Some of the German memoirs talk about the worst winter in 130 years and so on. That's not my understanding of it at all. Is it cold in Russia in October? And do the autumn rains, the rasputitsa, as they call it, the time without roads, is that typical? Absolutely. I teach a Russian history course. I teach 1,000 years of Russian history. October, November is when you get your heavy rains. It is not unlikely that they're going to get them. And in fact, this idea of freezing cold weather is not actually really true of October at all. It's raining a lot. That means that there's the roads are transforming into mud. But it's only getting very, very cold in the middle of the night. During the day, the temperature goes well above zero. So that's quite normal for October. And in October, it's going to get cold, and it's going to get very cold, and it will be a cold winter, no question, but not anything like this idea of some sort of 130-year shock event that it's cold in winter in November or October 1941. In fact, one of the German general staff officers wrote, and I'll quote it verbatimly, he said that it's cold in winter at this time of year is part of the ABC of warfare. So again, especially for the students watching this, people often who have an interest in this kind of thing go to what they see as a primary source and a very accessible primary source, German generals' memoirs. And the only thing I can say to those is, if you do want to read them, fair enough, go away and read them, but do two things. Read some good literature around them and recent literature, because earlier literature tended to take that stuff verbatim and accept it all. But I think good quality literature these days looks at those memoirs and archival source material to figure out what is true. It's not as though everything in those memoirs is untrue, but to look at what is true and what is not true. So we've got the muddy season. They've now departed from the encirclement. That force has largely been crushed, largely, not entirely. There are parts of that Vyazma encirclement, when you're talking about 80 square kilometers, where the Germans can't go through every part of the forest and comb it through. There are Soviet forces that escaped. The problem is the German front will continue to the east, and some of those Soviet forces that have escaped aren't going back to Soviet lines to get out. They are just stuck behind German lines, which has implications for the rest of the offensive and indeed the winter, because they are now acting as partisan forces. And this is a real problem. As the German front advances forward by a significant distance, they're going to drive on and they're going to take Mosheysk, another 100 kilometers. The bulk of the German armies are now moving east. What's left in the rear area are lonely roads. The days are getting shorter. There's a lot more darkness. That helps partisan warfare. And these guys, who are also hungry, looking for anything to eat and looking for any German targets to strike, are going to hit that one area where the Germans are weakest, which is logistics, where there's these lonely truck colonies driving through at very slow paces on bad roads through these forested areas, and these partisan forces, and don't think that partisan forces are a few dozen guys running around. We're talking hundreds of guys running around. In fact, in one instance I found in one of the archives, it was talking about engaging partisans, and the partisans are operating with artillery. So they have big pieces of equipment in some instances, and they're going to hit German supplies, making it once again, or compounding the problem the Germans already have of logistics. So the Soviet forces are in a terrible state. Zhukov is now commander of the Western Front, or you have to say the remnants of the Western Front. They are calling madly for any reserve armies from anywhere in the Soviet Union to come to Moscow to help reconstitute and rebuild this force. He only has about 90,000 men under his command. And keep in mind the Soviet Western Front, or that Soviet front opposing Army Group Center at the beginning of Typhoon, was 1.2 million. Now we're down to 90,000. So you've got a question to answer there. How is it that the Soviets are able to hold up the Germans with such a small number of forces? Well, a number of things. One, we've already alluded to the weather, but it's not as though every road is full of mud. There is still some movement, and there are still some roads as you get closer to Moscow that are actually quite good roads. With only 90,000 men, the Germans have a problem. This area that they're going to be driving through, once the roads start to get bad, it means that they can't go off-road. Part of the enacting of encirclements and destroying Soviet strong points is to simply outflank them. That's what you can do when you're a mobile army. The problem is the Germans move off these roads, which may not be very good, but they're better than going overland. Because again, even if the tanks can go overland, the trucks certainly can't follow. And those really are bottomless pits when you get out onto these fields or into dense forests where even the trucks or even the tanks can't drive through. So Zhukov has the advantage of being able to identify a number of major roads that are leading into Moscow. And he identifies about four roads. And he basically says, we only have to defend those roads. And then he takes the main positions on those roads. So in the north, Volokolamsk, it doesn't matter if you don't know where these places are, Moskhayask, and down at the very south, a place called Kaluga. And if we defend those, actually there's one more, and I can't remember off the top of my head which one that is, but there's a fourth. So there's four roads and there's four main towns, and he's going to defend those towns when you've got limited numbers, but he knows the Germans can't outflank those positions just by driving around them. They're going to have to go straight through his forces, and that gives him an advantage. You can then topple trees, you can dig up the roads, you can build defenses, and on a relatively narrow front, where your limited number of forces have more effect. And so he's not trying to hold the Germans, he's trying to delay the Germans, buying time, because the Soviet Union is raising new reserve armies and bringing them to Moscow. This is another problem the Germans have. They are moving away from their logistics, the Soviets are falling back on their logistics, and Moscow is a communication center. Train lines are leading into Moscow from the east, from the south, from the north, and they are, the Soviets, able to not just bring in reserve armies, but strip any other armies along the front and send them immediately to Moscow to try and reconstitute the front. There is real success in the south. Guderian has driven to Tula. That's another very important point. He is a long way from Moscow. Really, the drive on Moscow is taking place with the 4th Panzer Group, and that's about all. Guderian is trying to come up, but he is, and I can't remember off the top of my head exactly how far the distance is, but Tula is some 300 or so kilometers from Moscow, 250 kilometers perhaps. It's still a very long way away. So Guderian's not going to be coming anytime soon. The 3rd Panzer Group is off at Kalinin, trying to go further north, so they're absolutely not part of the picture, and indeed they're having enough trouble just holding on to Kalinin, because the new Soviet front in the north there, the Kalinin Front, as it will be called, under the command of Konev, is desperately trying to retake that town. So there's peripheral battles taking place here as well. It's the 4th Panzer Group with the 4th Army that are driving on Moscow, and they may be the most powerful formations on the Eastern Front, but they are being held up effectively by the conditions and by Soviet resistance. By the end of October, Bock, the commander of Army Group Center, reaches a very important decision. He basically decides the 9th Army in the very north, the 4th Army, and the 2nd Panzer Army, that's Guderian's army, are all going to halt. Because the biggest problem they have beyond just the weather, beyond the Soviet offensives, is they've got no more supplies. They've got no more fuel, haven't got much ammunition, and they need to build up more strength, bring more strength further forward in order to once again try and punch through Soviet formations and achieve the final, in the closest points, German armies are now by the end of October, around about 90 kilometers from Moscow. But they need to build up more forces in order to finally push on and make the last part of the offensive. What's interesting there is Bok concedes in his war diary where he writes, I know that this pause in our offensive will benefit the Soviets more than it will benefit my forces, but we simply can't go on anymore. We have literally nothing more. We have to bring things forward. Indeed, the second half of October, as the German forces are driving toward Moscow, what's actually happening, and it's a little bit deceptive on the maps. If you have a look at a map, you can see that there are German divisions that are advancing, but it's, again, only when you go down into the military files and look at these divisional files, do you really see what's going on. In order to sustain the advance, what's happening in these divisions is that the decision is we simply cannot support logistically the whatever number of tanks we have left in our division, 50 tanks. So what we will do is we will siphon the petrol out of 40 of the tanks so that we can get enough fuel to keep 10 of them going. Or if you're an infantry division, we will leave behind our artillery. We will just keep attacking with what they call combat groups, small groups out of the division that they make operationally as operational as they can make them so that they can keep attacking. The problem is on the map, it looks like 4th or 7th Panzer Division is attacking here, but it's not the 7th Panzer Division. The 7th Panzer Division is strung out over 100, 150 kilometers because they can't keep them all advancing. They're just trying to keep a part of it advancing, such as the commitment to this offensive, that just everything is thrown forward, everything, and nothing is held back. And that means the German front is actually quite weak at the front, and it's not really advancing. We're talking about a few hundred meters a day when you've got 90 kilometers, and that's only the closest division. Other divisions in the north, they're 120 kilometers or 130 kilometers from Moscow. It's a very, very long front, keep in mind. So there's a decision to hold all of these armies and build up supplies. They're also waiting for something else. The roads are so terrible, the Germans are now hoping, and now hoping for the winter to come so that it will freeze these roads. So much and all of the German generals say, oh, the weather was so terrible and, oh, wasn't that a big disadvantage? In fact, they were now hoping for, as soon as possible, the colder weather so that it can freeze these roads, but they don't want to have the really bad winter yet with deep snow. They're planning for that period between freezing conditions to stop these sludging roads and so that they can operate, they can move efficiently over these roads, because of course when the wheels spin, they're churning up their fuel and they're not getting any traction, so they're not really moving forward. It's a problem, hence stop the front, wait for the freeze to come, and then when the freeze comes, we can continue our offensive. And at this point, what I want to do is change a little bit tack. I want to come back to what I said at the beginning and address this question of why. If you're getting anything from this, and I'm sure there's a lot of people in the audience who are quite proficient in military matters, the one thing you'd have to say is the Germans are, with the dissipation of strength, with the weakness of their forces, and the fact that the Soviets are bringing in reserve armies from really all over the Soviet Union, and very importantly, Moscow has been fortified since July 1941. In those initial weeks when the Soviet front looked like it was falling apart, the Soviets started to fortify Moscow. Moscow is a very, very large city, and the streets are being barricaded, the houses are having pillboxes built into them. The entire industry of Moscow is being transformed in order to make this a defensive bastion. So it is not the case that just by looking at how many more kilometers is it to Moscow, and then we've achieved our objective. That is only going to be one part of the offensive in taking Moscow. You're going to have to go all the way there, and then you're going to have to fight one hell of a battle. Now, one of the things here, and I'm sure historians who might be watching this will perhaps question me on, is Hitler always says, we're not going to take Moscow. We don't want to get involved in a street fight there. But in order to encircle it, it's a very large metropolis. And encircling such a large metropolis is itself going to take an enormous amount of strength. And it's quite clear that as German forces get closer, they're going to, and Bok writes in his diary, he says, we can't take an enormous position like Moscow and have it behind our front. That's just not possible. We're going to have to make a very small so we're going to take the outer suburbs is what he's saying, basically. And that's going to be a very real fight. Indeed, there's been a few instances in the Eastern Front in 1941 of urban warfare. And in every instance, it's very clear German doctrine is not built for this. And it's enormously intensive, as we know from looking at the most famous battle of urban warfare in the Second World War for the Germans, Stalingrad. that, and that's a much smaller city, make no mistake, in comparison to Moscow. It's a much smaller city. And Germans, this is very resource intensive to fight there, and the German doctrine, fighting doctrine, while very good in open territory with tanks, is not built for urban warfare, and that's precisely what the Germans are heading into. So what I want to address now is this question of why. And to do this, it's very instructive to take another example. I mentioned that the 9th, the 4th, and the 2nd Panzer Army are all stalled. They're being held, waiting for the freeze. But there's a second army, the 2nd Army, which is at the very southern part of Army Group Center. I'll just try and get that map for you. So the 2nd Army does not have the same order. They must continue their offensive. So down here we have, I take it you can all see my map. Down here, this is the 2nd Army's flag. This is the 2nd Panzer Army driving on Tula. They've just gotten to Tula. They're still a very long distance from Moscow. Here is our offensive. Oh, hang on, I've got to go to the other part. Here is our offensive in the north. They've gone as far as, here is the Panzer Group 3. They've taken Kalinin. Well, actually, there's fighting on the outskirts of Kalinin. And they're trying to indeed drive further north. That's what they're going to try and do, is encircle parts of the Soviet Northwestern Front. And here we have the main offensive continuing, or it was continuing until this point. Now they're held west of Moscow, rebuilding their forces. But down here is the interesting one, I think. Second Army. If you look at almost any book on the Battle of Moscow, you'll hardly see these guys mentioned. It's a guy named Vikes who's in command. This is a backwater. This is the Soviet steppe. Who much cares what's happening down here? But I think there's something very instructive in terms of our problem that we have to answer as historians to explain what's going on here. And it's this question of why. Because the Second Army is the poor man's army of Army Group Center. They get the least amount of logistical support. They're also a smaller army, but they are driving on, and their objective has always been Kursk here. And if you think of Kursk, if anyone knows anything about the Eastern Front, the big summer offensive of 1943 is towards Kursk. But the little known thing about Kursk is actually in the Battle of Kursk in 1943, there is not a shot fired in anger in Kursk because the Germans never really get near Kursk. But in 1941, there's a very real battle, of course, where they actually do take the city, and no one's really much heard of it. But in any case, here they're driving on the city. And on the 1st, this map is from the 3rd, but on the 1st of November, the 9th Panzer Division, which belongs to the 2nd Army, and the 95th Infantry Division, which also belongs, they are driving on course, and they have given their all for this offensive. They have been driving here for weeks on end. They are at the end of their strength, at the end of their logistics, at the end of their resources. And on the 1st of October, the second Army's war diary states very clearly, in the assault on Kursk, both divisions will give their last, so that after carrying out the attack, a rest period will be absolutely necessary. And there's a lot more to that effect. In other words, these forces are going to achieve this objective, and that will be all they can do. There'll be 2 days of intensive street fighting, and then they will have taken Kursk. The important thing I want to get across to you is they take Kursk, and they've achieved their objective. I'll go back to my other screen. I hope you have me now. They've achieved their objective. They've taken Kursk. They are now in a large urban area where they can bring up supplies, they can fortify their front. We're on the 3rd of October, so the winter is just before them. You would think, okay, congratulations, they have achieved their objective. Maybe even you can dissipate some of that strength and send it further north to help in the main offensive. But actually what happens is, and then one more statistic, the 9th Panzer Division has 7 tanks left in it. It's a division on paper. In practice, it's got 7 tanks, and it's stretched out over 260 kilometers of the advanced route. Again, that same phenomenon. There's only 7 tanks that are operational left, but a large part of that division is actually stretched out over the course of their advanced route. The 95th Infantry Division has no artillery at Kursk. So there are very real and very profound problems, and that entry I just read to you about them absolutely needing a rest is quite clear. But on the 3rd of November 1941, the OKH, which is the high command of the German army, They send down new orders to Vikes, the commander of the Second Army, saying that you will now continue your offensive and you will take the city of Voronezh, which is all of 200 kilometers further east of Kursk. Now, if you have a sense, as I do, and I sit in that archive and I read for days on end about the condition of these forces, and there's no ambiguity as to how dilapidated their strengths are and so on, and how problematic, and these reports are legion in these forces. They're sending the reports up. The same files that I'm reading are the files that the high command in the German army should be reading, and indeed are reading. They are not concluding, as you would think they would, well, we have to limit our operations. In fact, they are driving their forces forward 200 kilometers at this time of year with these forces. Now, you have to ask yourself the question, what is going on here? And when I started writing the Battle for Moscow book, which comes, my first book on the Battle of Moscow is Operation Typhoon. It takes in October. The second book is the Battle of Moscow. I'm at the start of that book, and I'm encountering the Battle of Kursk, and I'm sitting there, and I have a problem. I'm sitting there thinking, I can't just tell my audience what happens, as I'm telling you what happens. I can read the files and tell you what happens. I can read the files and tell you which orders are given. What I have to do is explain to you why it happens. But I didn't have an explanation at that point. I was sitting there thinking, I've been explaining German operations for the last three books and talking about the hubris of the German armies, their overconfidence, which I think makes some sense in those books. I think it's a reasonable answer, because there always were military resources to achieve an objective, not equal to the objective, but at least still military resources the Germans had to try and achieve those objectives. They may have been optimistic, perhaps extremely optimistic, but they still have military resources. The point at which I got to Kursk, I said, this doesn't work anymore. Because there's nothing here. This is just so clearly a fool's errand to try and reach Voronezh with 200 kilometers of terrain with literally no resources. And it's coming up clearly from the 48th Panzer Corps, from the 9th Panzer Division, from the 2nd Army's reports, from the 95th Infantry Division's reports. They are universally saying, "This is you've got to be kidding me. This can't be done." But orders are orders in the German Army. And they will be marching out on the 4th of November trying to achieve their objective. Will they get there? Absolutely not. Will it be a bit of a disaster for them? Absolutely it will be. But again, the question has to be answered, why are they doing this? And I think there is an answer here. And I think it's the same answer for that small, well, not so small, but that microcosm of a battle east of Kursk as it is for the whole Battle of Moscow. In order to understand, because as we go through October, we will see that the German armies as we go through November, we will see that the German armies, as they close in on Moscow, again, it's a very improbable, not even improbable, there are very long odds against them achieving their objective. The logistics aren't there, the firepower isn't there. And what is there is large numbers of Soviet forces, which aren't even in the battle. They're being held back east of Moscow or around Moscow in preparation for what will be the Soviet counteroffensive. The Soviets are fighting tooth and nail at the front line, and the Germans see that they're fighting tooth and nail at the front line, but there are actually other Soviet armies. The pressure and stress of October for the Soviet high command is very much dissipating in November, because they're aware, okay, we've other forces we can pull into the battle if indeed we need them. And indeed, by the end of the month, they're not only planning the defense of Moscow, they're planning their major offensive. The Germans, however, are never deterred. They will keep attacking. They will keep attacking out of 78 divisions. I've got that figure on top of my head. I'm not sure if it's exactly the figure of divisions, 78 German divisions in Army Group Center for Typhoon. By the end of the month, they will be attacking with about four of them in the early days of December. The offensive ends on the 5th of December when the Germans finally call a halt to it. But they'll keep attacking, even when they've only got four divisions that are operational. The rest are all burnt out, but they'll still keep attacking. In other words, the offensive mindset, we talk about a cult of the offensive before the First World War and other armies that are very offensively minded, and Rob Sottino's done some fantastic work on just how offensive the German army was in the 19th century, in the early 20th century, but the German Wehrmacht is another degree above that. Offensive to the point of absolute folly, but nonetheless offensive. And if we're answering the question, why is this? I think we have to understand that the German army is operating under what I now call national socialist military thinking. There is something about the German army that that makes up why they do this, and it's very much a fusing of ideology. The Nazi state is naturally very much an ideological state, but the German army after the war, the German generals and even some of the historians tried to say, oh, well, the army was different. It was the Nazi party doing terrible things, including the Holocaust, and then there was the German army and they weren't doing these sorts of things. That's absolutely false. First of all, and I think I alluded to it in my last lecture, the German army is deeply implicated in the Holocaust, and the Holocaust doesn't begin with Auschwitz and all the death camps. It begins on the Eastern Front in the summer of 1941 with mass killings, hundreds of thousands of Jews into anti-tank ditches and all the rest of it. And while that is being conducted primarily by the Einsatzgruppen, which are SS or SD, it's a sub-arm of the SS, SS forces, make no mistake, the German army is supplying these Einsatzgruppen with all their logistics, and indeed in some instances have taken part in them, but absolutely no question, the higher command of the German army, the field commanders, division, corps, and above, they all know full well what's going on and they don't have a problem with it. How many of those guys resign out of disgust at the mass killing of Jewish women and children? All of none. So the argument that the German army somehow didn't know or didn't want this or wasn't implicated, as you still sometimes see if you look on the internet and you look, I can see it's the comments from my last lecture where some of the extreme right have made their comments. They always try and dispute these things, but there is no question, none whatsoever, in the better literature, and there's an enormous amount in German on this and some very good stuff in English, of how deeply implicated the German Wehrmacht is. Now, that is not to be understood as just German policy vis-a-vis the Jews or vis-a-vis mass killing. We are, I think, kidding ourselves if when we step outside that ideological mass killing and move into the strictly military sphere of what the German army do, to think that there isn't a carryover and to think that there isn't implications of that Nazi worldview. What makes you a person who can sign off on such horrific events has implications for that strictly military realm. And I think we can show this in a number of ways. Precisely what I said before, Rob Cetino's great work, this offensive German mentality, it's not as big a step as you might think between being an offensive military and driving forward and always trying to achieve the next objective and keeping your enemy off balance and going yet a step further, where everything is given in the offensive to the point of saying rational decisions are no longer determined by what is on paper and rather by what is in your mind. That may not make much sense, but let me make that a little bit clearer. Adolf Hitler, if you think to yourself, what did he say in all those speeches? In the 1930s, he gives long speeches. In the war, he gives long speeches. He sometimes gets up for 3 hours and gives speeches. What does he talk about? He talks about how he basically tells his life story, how he triumphed, how he did all these things. The Leni Riefenstahl film, Triumph of the Will, that's Hitler right there. He achieved great success. He went from this corporal in the trenches of the First World War to the leader of Germany. He solved all their economic problems, etc., etc., etc. He won't talk about all the relating factors that led to this and the luck along the way that led to this. It's not about that. It's about him, and it's about how he overcame this enormous adversity, and that he, through the primacy of will, directed Germany, and as the great leader, led them to success. And so the implication there is, when he's talking to the armed forces, is if we had a nation of 80 million people who were directed by their will, and it didn't matter about the adversity that surrounds them, but were directed by an indomitable will that will not, in any circumstances, no matter how bad the material imbalance or whatever else, if you have the same idea as I do of this primacy of will, you can force through and succeed in every instance. And then we start to come back to these kinds of examples where, in a rational world that we inhabit, I'd like to think I'm a rational person. I'm sure my audience who read and hear my lectures, read my books, are a rational audience. They want to understand these things in a rational way, but it doesn't quite equate. I think that's part of the reason why it was taken 70 years to get to National Socialist military thinking, because previous books to the Battle of Moscow, it's not as though they haven't ever tried to answer this question, but what they're doing is taking these seemingly absurd military events and putting them in a language that the audience and the historian can understand. They're transforming the irrational to the rational. And subtly, this sort of process goes on where we're making sense of what doesn't really make sense. And I think the only way you can understand what the Germans are doing is not in our world, in a rational world. Remember, the Nazi state abrogates a lot of the concepts of the early modern Enlightenment, morality, law. So when they're doing these kinds of things and abrogating these accepted norms of the modern world, is it so far to assume that they're also abrogating concepts of Clausewitz, modern norms of military operations and so on? And I think that's exactly what they're doing here. And I think that's exactly why, to understand what they're doing, we don't have to understand it in terms that make sense to us, because they don't make sense. We have to make sense of it in terms that make sense to the Nazis. In other words, we have to understand, what is the Nazi worldview? How do they understand it? And if you believe in a primacy of will, that you are a good commander, and you're going to tell me you can't make Voronezh, well, I'll tell you what, I can find someone who says they will. And there are other men, for career reasons, but also because there's no shortage of Nazi officers in the German Wehrmacht who will say, yes, sir, I can achieve that objective, just give me the chance. And therefore, you start to see rather absurd things being attempted. You could say that is the whole history of the Eastern Campaign, and the implications of National Socialist military thinking are not just relevant to the Battle of Moscow or to Voronezh, they're relevant to the entire Second World War. When we get to the Battle of Stalingrad or so on, you know, if you read those books, and there's some wonderful books out there on it, but when we're talking about taking that last factory before we get to the Volga, does it really matter if they take the last factory? The entire army group south is so deep into the Soviet Union, and the Soviet forces have already come around and are building huge armies on their flanks about to crush them, and the Germans are worried about one factory or this house in the city that's hundreds of kilometers at the end of their logistic lines, and they're about to be encircled, and they don't see it. And then you go to the next year of offensive. Again, no learning curve, because in a Nazi worldview, there's no questioning the basic premise. The orders are given and the orders will be executed. And there's no, well, hang on, no, I don't think this makes any sense. As there might be in an American command, if someone was told, well, you're going to go out there, and the guy said, this is suicide, he might well question his orders. He might well, brought up in a rational framework where he says, I'm not going to get my men killed for some absurd mission that cannot be achieved. And I would like to think that's the case in the British and the Australian Army. It's our tradition. That's not the case in the German Army. And it answers a lot of questions I think we've struggled to answer when we go to the very end of the war and we see German soldiers fighting. And it's something my students ask me all the time. Why are they fighting in March 1945 when it is so clearly over? Well, if you're an American soldier, that's exactly what you'd be asking. If you're a National Socialist, and remember, the soldiers are sometimes worse than the generals because they've been brought up in the Hitler Youth and all the rest of it. They don't answer that question because, as the German propaganda of the time said, enjoy the war, the peace will be much worse. You believe in that, then there is no war. There is no after the war. There is no peacetime solution. There is annihilation, because we believe in a world that is success and triumph or utter devastation. And that makes sense, because what were the Germans doing when they were triumphant in the East? Mass killing their enemies. So it's not such a big step, but it explains a lot about the Eastern Front. It explains a lot about the battle for Moscow. And indeed, I would go so far as to say you can't understand the Eastern Front without National Socialist military thinking. And now I have no idea where I'm at in my notes. Okay, on the 7th of November, Helder is writing in his war diary about minimum and maximum lines of the offensive. So just to recap, on the 7th of November, Army Group Center is largely stationary. Only the Second Army is very, very slowly trying to get out of course and commence its new offensive towards Voronezh. The rest of the army group is held. And Helder is planning the next stage of the offensive. And he comes up with what he calls minimum and maximum lines of the offensive. We are going to launch out again and drive in the direction of Moscow. So how far should we go? This is the Commander-in-Chief of the Army General Staff. And this, I think, is an indication of what I just explained, this idea of National Socialist military thinking. Helder's minimum line for the Eastern Front will reach... let me just get this right, 220 kilometers to the east from their starting line. So where they are now, he wants to drive 220 kilometers east. So even the rest of the German army is not just going to be trying to get, sorry, it's not just the Second Army that's going to be trying to reach 200 kilometers. He wants to drive 220 kilometers east with Army Group Center. That is, of course, well east of Moscow, and he's going to be attempting that. That's also his minimum line. His maximum line sees a further 120 to 145 kilometers on top of that 220. So doing the calculations, what is that, sort of 350 to 400 kilometers further east is the maximum line. So we are talking an enormous distance, and it's completely inconsistent with the state of the German army. It's completely inconsistent with the time of year, and it's completely inconsistent with what the Soviets are building up. Okay, the only thing you might say there is the Germans aren't really aware because their intelligence service is so bad. Foreign Armies East, which gives them the information, is completely unaware of these Soviet reserve armies. They think everything the Soviets have in front of Moscow, or sorry, to defend Moscow, is what they're directly engaging right now, which are still Soviet armies that have been reconstituted and with whatever forces have been brought up from Moscow. But they think if we can just beat them, which again goes back to this this other idea, how many times have they crushed the Soviet front? And they're no longer enacting encirclements. They've given up on that idea. They haven't got the mobility to do it. They are now in a grinding frontal offensive, which just drives the Soviets' force forward, back, and just pushes with all the might they can muster. So this is a real problem for Army Group Center in terms of continuing their offensive and being able to drive onto Moscow. And it's completely inconsistent with objectives being set by Helder. Now, Helder, when he does go to the front, he'll go to the front in early October, and he will try and he'll have a meeting with a lot of the chiefs of staff of the various armies there, and they will tell him categorically, the chiefs of staff aren't the commanders of the armies, they're the guys who do the paperwork. So they're kind of the numbers guys, and they are going to tell Helder in no uncertain terms, what you're proposing is completely irrational. There's no way we can achieve these. But that doesn't mean the German army is going to cancel their offensive, and it doesn't mean they're going to try and not achieve those. I can see George is there. George, did you want to get to questions?
You've blown us away here. We're having an epiphany of this triumph of will, and I think this audience, when you laid that out, you could have heard a pin drop. I saw people at the edge of their chair.
Professor Stahel, thank you for bringing your classroom expertise to our classroom. Thank you very much.